Your eyes do not deceive. Okay. All right. I gotta admit, that was a pretty good one. All right. Brian, I love that. Okay. Your eyes do not deceive you, ladies and gentlemen. Do not adjust your sets. It's just little old me, your connection to the wrestling world, the articulate, the immaculate, the spectacular, Ken Hill, coming to you live from Bedford TV Studios for episode 76 of the Masterpiece Theater of Professional Wrestling, The Wrestling Connection. Now, of course, we are fast approaching SummerSlam, and it's building up to be quite the summertime spectacular. Of course, it would have to be for WWE, who gave it a whopping 4 hours instead of the typical three, because of course we get enough of 3 hour Raws. So of course we need a four hour pay per view. Gotta love that WWE logic. Anyway, we'll jump right into things here. We open not with an authority promo, thank God, but with WWE World Champion Seth Rollins, who once again was proclaiming himself to be a magnanimous soul, and felt sorry for John Cena, and wanted the chance to speak to him and see if he would accept his challenge for his title for title match at SummerSlam. Now, we thought we were going to have John Cena, but of course it was Rollins up to his usual hijinks, using a still of Cena to play a fun little word game. And of course we see Cena with his obtruse broken nose, looking much like a resemblance of King Barrett right there. Rollins made it seem like that Cena wasn't willing to accept, that he wouldn't be around to compete, and was pretty much ready to take the night off from SummerSlam and formally accept Cena's U.S. title in forfeit. However, before he could get to that, he was oh so rudely, and thankfully for us, gladly interrupted by not only Cesaro, but Kevin Owens, who have been having quite the tiff themselves the last couple of weeks, both saying that if Cena was going to be out, that both of them would lay claim to number one contendership status. However, then came the Viper, Randy Orton, who Rollins has had many an issue with, saying that he was ready to strike and claim his claim his 13th world championship. Triple H then would come out. So of course we couldn't have an opening segment without some member of the authority. Go figure. And decided to make a triple threat number one contenders match between the Viper Randy Orton, Kevin Owens, and Cesaro. Get to that a little later on. Now, of course, we kick things off with some divas action. We had Team Bad facing off with the two founding members of Team Bella, of course, the Bella Twins. Now, I mean, you can imagine, two heel teams. I mean, who do we root for here? Well, with the impending return of her husband, Daniel Bryan, the crowd saw fit to get behind Brie Bella and, to a lesser extent, Nikki. Now, the Bellas would pick up the win thanks to a roll up by Brie on Tamina. And, of course, things would break down. And, of course, then there was the involvement of the newly renamed group led by Paige, P- PCB, Paige, Charlotte, and Becky, which sounds more like a name for industrial waste. Sadly enough. Great job there, creative. Cause God forbid you get... I mean, one thing getting your name from an adult site. Another thing to be naming one of your leading female groups after government waste. Nice. Nice job. But anyway, even though there are still some glaring omissions, such as some glaring mistakes in this whole Divas Revolution, such as Sasha not carrying her NXT championship, there not being a real established number one contender to Nikki Bella's Divas Championship, we're still getting good quality and quantity in terms of Divas matches, and that's slowly but surely overcoming the small mistakes and hiccups that the Divas Revolution has experienced. And we would find out later on that a big-time Divas match has been made for SummerSlam, a triple threat elimination 9 diva tag team match, Team PCB versus Team Bad versus Team Bella. Now, while of course this is just another stalling tactic for Nikki's Divas seemingly record-breaking Divas Championship reign, it's nonetheless a good way, an excellent way to put the fully established Divas, put them on the map in terms of the Divas Revolution. Now moving on, we get to the triple threat number one contenders match. Randy Orton versus Cesaro versus Owens. Now, Cesaro and Owens in this match makes sense to me because, okay, that they've not only been having problems with each other, but they've also had some chemistry in the ring with Rollins. They've both laid claim to number one contendership status. They both feel like they could thusly be the number one contender for Rollins' WWE World Championship. It seemed like Orton was just kind of thrown in there, because we know of Orton's feud with Sheamus, so the fact that they kind of threw Orton in the WWE World title mix, even with Orton being a perennial world title contender, just seemed kind of out of left field. Because, frankly, Cesaro versus Rollins, or Owens versus Rollins, would have been an excellent main event for Raw, any way you look at it. Didn't matter how it end, it would have been an excellent match that for once didn't really feature the likes of Orton or Cena or Sheamus. And not to say it wasn't an entertaining triple threat match. It had its ups and downs, roller coaster of offense. I mean, lots of excellent near falls. And certainly a very snappy ending where Owens attempted to go for a pop-up powerbomb on Cesaro, only for Cesaro to float over and Owens to suffer an RKO from the Viper Orton, who had seemingly been laid out only minutes earlier, and then Cesaro himself being the victim of our RKO, and Orton picking up the quick three count in what was a very entertaining triple threat match, which of course meant that Orton would face Rollins later on tonight for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. Now, an interesting part of this week's Raw was, of course, the ringside presence of Arrow's, the star of the hit show Arrow, Stephen Amell. Now, of course, we know that Stardust has been having issues not only with the man that gravity forgot, Neville, but Stephen Amell himself, whom Stardust is deluded into thinking is actually Arrow rather than just an actor portraying it, and has been obsessed with getting Amell to be his hero, as Stardust has seemingly portrayed himself as a super villain. Not that we have enough of those. Oh, if there was ever a time for the Hurricane to make his return to WWE, that would be a real superhero. However, we have to settle for Stephen Amell, who Stardust tried to antagonize, as we see here, not getting in Amel's face, and then giving him the old, what's called in the business, the pie face. This would motivate Amel to jump into the ring, which typically is a no-no for any fan, doesn't matter if you're a big name fan or not, and actually assault Stardust, laying several punches before he had to be pulled off. Now, what's lost inside of this is the fact that just previously to this whole confrontation between these two, we had a match between Neville, again a ongoing rival of Stardust's, and King Barrett. Now, what's notable about this is the fact that Neville, who came close to beating Barrett but came out on the short end of the stick for the King of the Ring title, ended up beating the King of the Ring in under a minute. Now, that's not the interesting part. What's interesting is that the backstage segment following this, Amel is being held back by security. He wants revenge against Stardust. Neville's willing to back him up. And Triple H, goes through the whole, hold harmless agreement, paperwork, and all that jazz, and makes the match for Stephen Amell, Arrow, and Neville versus Stardust and Bad News Barrett. Triple H actually said Bad News Barrett, not King Barrett. And according to that, and recent internet news, it seems the plan is that they're going to phase Barrett back into his old Bad News gimmick and kind of do away with the King gimmick, which I think is for the best. Because the last two individuals we've had as King of the Ring, both Barrett and Sheamus, actually suffered from having a kingly gimmick given to them. It works for some, like King William Regal, King Booker. It works for some. But the last two, Sheamus and Barrett, it just took away from their character, took away from their intensity, took away from their in-ring prowess, and it just really didn't get them over the crowd. Barrett's Bad News gimmick, that got over with the crowd, that got more pops, and that got Barrett more in with the WWE audience. So frankly, if he goes back to this, I think it'll be a big upswing for Barrett, who's frankly hit the bottom of the barrel if he loses to Neville within a minute. So, I mean, anyway, switching gears. Couldn't find a photo for this, but it's been an interesting build to the Tag Team Championship match at SummerSlam. I mean, several teams have thrown their hat into the ring, including the former champs New Day, Lucha Dragons, and Los Matadores. I guess the Ascension were too busy, or they got shipped back down to NXT. Sorry, boys. And anyway, we had a tag team match between the New Day and Los Matadores, in which the New Day ended up picking up a seemingly big win. And it seems like that, okay, instead of having one solid build up to a tag team match, WWE's logic going to SummerSlam is, hey, let's just have all these teams pick up random wins over each other with no momentum gained whatsoever. And then, just for the heck of it, let's throw them all into a big four-team tag team match, a fatal four-way for the WWE tag team titles. Why don't we just do that? I mean, don't get me wrong. I love multi-man matches. I love multi-team matches. Like I said, I was a big fan of the Tag Team Elimination Chamber match and, of course, the Fatal 4-Way at WrestleMania. But, I mean, like I said, this is just lazy booking, okay? At least with the WrestleMania Fatal 4-Way, you had some buildup among the four teams. You had former champions. You had contenders in Los Matadores who actually beat the champions to earn an opportunity. Here, you just had teams beating on each other. There's no real momentum gain from either any team. I mean, New Day, of all teams, has seemingly been on the bottom, winning this one match, having lost for the last 2-3 weeks, and having lost to the primetime players twice at pay-per-views. So this just sort of screams for New. This whole match screams for New Day winning the tag team titles without having to beat Primetime Players. But I'll get more into that next week when we have our SummerSlam preview. View. All right. So anyway, we come to the main event. Seth Rollins versus Randy Orton. Now, this, I mean, if you've seen one Rollins-Orton's match, I mean, you've seen plenty. I mean, we saw a lot of these two at WrestleMania, at Extreme Rules, and they put together a very serviceable match. However, the glaring problem here wasn't with how the match ended up, because, of course, we couldn't expect Rollins to obviously lose, but for some reason, they didn't feel the need to have him win either. Of course, you remember that Orton's been feuding with Sheamus. Sheamus has the money in the bank. So, and we got a pretty obvious, blatant, not even a hint from Sheamus, all but a declaration that he was going to cash in no matter who came out on top between Rollins and Orton. Anyway, we come to the end of the match. Rollins goes for a springboard, of course, which is never a good idea against Orton, who comes up with an RKO out of nowhere. And seemingly closing in on his 13th World Championship, only for Sheamus to pull Orton out of the ring, leading to the disqualification on Rollins, which means he retains his championship. However, Sheamus would whip Orton to the barricade, bro kick Rollins, and was seemingly all but ready to cash in. But then you saw how obvious it was that they were stalling. Okay, Sheamus took forever to give the briefcase to the ref. The ref took his sweet time, telling the ringside announcers that, okay, Sheamus was cashing in. And it seemed all but a very glaring stalling tactic for Orton to come back in and hit the RKO. That's all well and good when it's, like, impulsive, when it's, like, spur of the moment. But when it's so played out like this, like, okay, you're stalling, you're waiting for Orton for his cue, that just shows how, like how rehearsed wrestling can be. When you pull it off right, it seems, like I said, spur of the moment, impulsive, just like a flash. Comes out of nowhere. Like this, it was a pretty weak ending to Raw overall. So, I mean, so you're going to have the go-home show to SummerSlam. It's going to have to be out-of-the-park type show. Because, I mean, you have your second biggest pay-per-view, you need to have a pretty big Raw leading into it. So I would certainly hope it's something more eventful and shocking than a pretty overly rehearsed Money in the Bank cash-in. All right, so I mean, we seemingly have everything in place for SummerSlam. We're likely going towards Sheamus versus a rematch between Sheamus and Orton. We've heard news that Cena is very likely for SummerSlam, meaning we'll have the title versus title match between him and Rollins, which, I mean, I admit is interesting. It's certainly unique, but I've been a big proponent. Everyone here has been a big fan of Cena's U.S. Open Challenge, just because it's been one of the best parts of WWE in 2015. And with Rollins holding both championships, I'm not sure if we would get that same feeling, okay? I'm not sure if we would get the same sort of quality and the same excitement that we've seen with Cena putting his U.S. title on the line. But again, we'll elaborate more on that in next week's pay-per-preview. Of course, we have that. We also have another match that was officially made for SummerSlam, Cesaro versus Kevin Owens. Now, frankly, if Cena could not make it to SummerSlam, I would have loved to see these two go out with Rollins over the WWE World Championship, but I digress. We have Cesaro versus Owens. Of course, like I said, we have the Fatal 4-Way Tag Team Title Match. We have the Triple Threat 9 Diva Elimination Tag Team Match. We have Arrow and Neville versus Bad News Barrett and Stardust. Stardust. And Stardust, we have Undertaker versus Brock Lesnar. The rematch, too big for WrestleMania. And Undertaker, who's too old for TV. Yeah, too old to go it alone. So anyway, I mean, it seems like that WWE's got a pretty solid build-up for SummerSlam, a pretty solid card, and should be more than enough to hold the crowd over for 4 hours. However, they're going to be in New York, which is a pretty snark-heavy crowd, so the WWE's going to have to bring their A game for this one and provide some quality to their matches, quality and quantity in terms of match time. I mean, maybe except for the Amel Neville versus Stardust Barrett. That's a novelty match at best. That should frankly be on the pre-show. Probably won't. Probably get one of the main event slots. But we'll see. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, that is our show for this afternoon. It's 5 o'clock. I consider it evening. Anyway, if you have any comments or questions about the show, if you'd like to submit some of your own predictions for the upcoming SummerSlam pay-per-view, you can email us at wrestlingconnection@gmail.com. You can also hit us up on our official Facebook page, facebook.com/thewrestlingconnection. We also have our official YouTube page where you can view all of our past and present episodes, including our one-year anniversary special. And, of course, you can also hit us up on Twitter at WConnection, where you can hear all of my lovely quips about WWE, Raw, the McMahon family, and, of course, the upcoming SummerSlam pay-per-view. In the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, I look forward to seeing you all next week for the SummerSlam preview. Be connected. Get connected.
Oh, yeah! Oh, yeah!
Have a good night, ladies and gentlemen.